Okay, would like to call the meeting back to order after that brief recess. And we will pick up the agenda on 4.13. And we're happy to have Lundy and Joanna to talk to us.
Thank you. Appreciate the opportunity this evening. We are here to talk about our health plan renewal for the budget year FY 2018. We have some information that's been updated since the information was initially presented during your retreat back in February. So we just want to provide that update and seek your permission to move forward with our plan changes. Just as a very quick background, the county offers two health plans to our employees, an open access plan, which is a very traditional type plan with an HRA account. And then we also have a consumer-directed plan, which has a health savings account. Of those two plans, about 60% of our employees are on the HSA plan. The other, of course, 40% are on the OAP. The OAP plan is the pricier of the two plans, as the information has come in. The health insurance renewal called for a 7% increase over last year's budget, so that would take us up over $10 million for the first time. It's a huge expense, and we have been looking at ways to bring down that increase in that expense. There are four proposals we would like to put out that we have also shared with our employees. We shared it with department heads during their meeting. We used our supervising and Cabarrus training platform to share information with that group. And we had forums, which we offered to employees. About 20 employees participated. So we've had an opportunity to present it, have had very little feedback from our employees. So the four items we would like to present tonight are: number one, to have all of our new hires with coverage effective 7/1 or thereafter go on to the HSA plan. That would only give them one choice. Existing employees would still be able to move between the two plans. The goal with this is that we would change the balance. Right now, as I said, it's about 60-40. So with that move, we would expect over time to have more folks, just because of the change, be on the HSA plan. We're also planning to do some additional education. We feel like that plan might be a better option for existing employees. But again, with new hires, we'd like to start them on the HSA plan only. If you have questions as I go, I can slow it down, or I can present all four and take questions as you prefer. So the second proposal impacts our retirees, and it's basically centered around their dependents. Unless they have an agreement with the county, the vacation agreement folks signed several years back, then they would not be allowed to make a change to add dependents after the time of their retirement. It's basically just asking them to make a change to elect to bring dependents on the plan at the time they retire. Beyond that point, they would only be able to drop dependents and not add. The impact of that is to limit future claims coming in without having an adequate amount of premium to offset that. The third item is focused on the OAP plan. As I noted, that plan is the pricier of our two options based on the claims experience. We would like to propose eliminating the HRA. That is the account where the county has provided $225 to these employees for the past 4 years or so. It's a benefit that has been limited in that it was only used for expenses like their specialty copays. They were not able to use it for premiums, or rather their pharmacy expenses. So it hasn't been widely used by employees. Money does come back to the county with this. The other piece of this is it has a high administration fee. So by eliminating this option, we can reduce the renewal by a little over 1%. So we feel like this is a good way to kind of balance out the plans and help make the renewal a lower rate. The fourth item also impacts that OAP plan, and that is to look at the plan deductible and make a change from the current $1,000 deductible to $1,500. That would bring that deductible to the same level as the current HSA plan, which we feel would be a comparable thing and maybe a fair thing to have them both at the same level. With that, we would not need to do a premium increase with the employees wishing to stay on that plan, and that alone would bring the renewal down another 4+%. So with these two changes, we would come in at 1.72% for the renewal. At this point, we don't feel there is any adverse impact to employees based on the the responses we've gotten. So we request the ability to move forward with both these proposals for our plan design that will then feed into the budget, and also schedule education and sessions for our employees so they have a better understanding of the two plan options for this year. Are there any questions? And Joanna, our health and wellness manager, is here with me if you have detailed questions about the plan or our proposals.
So everybody gets to stay where they are if they want to.
Current employees.
But if the smaller percentage stays with this OAP plan, they'll have a higher deductible and they will lose the, what amount was it?
$225 is what's funded. It's not always used, but that has been available.
So it's entirely possible that some employees, if they look at those changes and think they would prefer the other plan, then they can switch.
Absolutely.
And you had mentioned that they could move back and forth, but if somebody's on the HSA plan now, do they still have the option of going to that other one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so they still have that flexibility.
They would, and we feel like that's...
New hires would not have
correct.
That flexibility.
And they would not going forward either. So during open enrollment in future years, only the employees who are here at this time would have that ability to move back and forth between the plans. And we feel like that will help employees to make the best decision for their families. They can look at the plans on a yearly basis, and if one plan is better for their situation, it gives them the ability to do that. We would like to provide education to our employees because we feel like the HSA plan long-term might be a better option for more employees, but it's a tough concept to get your head around, and you do have to be able to fund that HSA account to pay for those initial out-of-pocket expenses. The county does provide a $750 HSA account, but if you have claims that are higher than that, then employees may have some concerns about how they would fund those out-of-pocket expenses. The clinic is also a big part of that plan. Employees have the ability to use our health clinic at a $5 payment if they have the HSA plan. So we would like to continue encouraging utilization of the clinic.
What's the deductible on the HSA plan?
It's for the employee, it's $1,500 as well, so it would level the two, so it will be equivalent.
Which, compared to a lot of personal insurance policy, that's a low deductible.
And the out-of-pocket, and I know you told us what that was, I think, didn't you?
For the HSA, the out-of-pocket maximum for employee only is $3,500. It's $5,000 for family on the health savings account plan.
What does OAP stand for?
Open Access Plan.
Okay.
And that is just kind of a name that our carrier has dubbed that plan. But it is a very traditional plan, co-pays.
Okay. Any questions? Okay. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is also Lundy again, Health Plan Renewal Budget Year. Is that what we just... Those are two we're tied to get. Okay. I did missing my check mark with a little break there. Okay, next is 4.14, Infrastructure and Asset Management, Transfer of Surplus Vehicles, and Kyle Bilfer and Michael Miller.
Good afternoon. The Midland Volunteer Fire and Rescue Incorporated has requested two surplus vehicles from Cabarrus County Sheriff's Office for their chief officers and administrative staff to take on errands, community outreach, public relations, and training trips. The county will have several sheriff's office cars up for surplus by the end of March and early April timeframe. However, the county fleet maintenance staff has not identified two exact cars that could be transferred, but we have confirmed that there are several vehicles available. The requested action of the board is a motion to declare two sheriff's office car surplus property and authorize disposition in accordance with county policy. And I'd be glad to answer any questions.
When those cars are, when that happens, is the maintenance, where does that How's the maintenance handled?
We literally will drop the cars off, take the permanent plates, and they're responsible
and you're done.
For fuel. Yes. So essentially, like we just surplus the car, except this time it goes to a nonprofit or another governmental entity. That's correct.
I have one question for you.
Yes.
I may have asked this one time in the past because we've done this numerous times in the last.
It's getting more and more, isn't it?
Yeah. And that's why I say I hope I'm not being redundant. But are there a waiting list for entities looking for these vehicles like this? And if there was, how do you get moved up?
Okay, that's a loaded question a couple ways.
No, not really. I mean, I just don't know. I have my own curiosity.
There's not a waiting list. We typically have 3 to 4 different entities that ask. And it's not every year. It's kind of every other year. If we ever had a list, we would probably bring it in front of you and prioritize that list. But we haven't heard from Midland Volunteer and Fire and Rescue in a few years,
right.
To be honest with you. We mostly get hit with some of the other volunteer fire companies have continuously come back, but we haven't heard from these folks in a while.
I think the last one we gave to was O'Dell, I believe. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and then we also did one to Harrisburg.
Right.
But it was a truck, and it was predominantly to haul around the trailer that has all the traffic things, which our actually sheriff's department provided for them.
Right.
So we try to work in conjunction, but if we ever had enough where we didn't have the surplus vehicles to fit it, we would probably wait to compile the whole list and come in front of you.
Right. Well, that's a good thing that we get it out from under our maintenance crew because we're always replacing these vehicles.
Yes,
with
we
new
are.
Ones. And so the maintenance is being replaced, and we don't need to add. We need to take away if we can. So. Yeah.
That's could not agree
thing.
More.
Good thing.
So if we did not have requests, then we would sell these at auction, GovDeals?
It's at the auction house. We actually don't use GovDeals for our vehicles. They go up to the auction house that would be, if you're familiar, right near Camp Spencer in Reimertown.
Okay.
And we have very good results with them. And people ask me all the time, or ask Michael and I all the time, what we would look at getting for those vehicles. I will tell you that it ranges depending on the year you take it up there, but I could estimate on these vehicles anywhere from $2,200 to $5,500. It kind of depends on who's out there in a day, or if there's pickup trucks and somebody wants that versus the four doors. There's no rhyme or reason.
Right.
I brought stuff up there that I'm pretty surprised somebody bought. So just being honest.
Okay, other questions for Michael and Kyle? Great, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next item, 4.15, storage area network refresh lease agreement, and we're glad to have Todd Shanley to talk with us about that.
Good evening. So a storage area network, just to provide some context, is our disk infrastructure for the county. So at the core of it, what we're asking for you to do is to authorize the county manager to basically renew this lease with sign a new lease with a new agency. For this, we lease this equipment for 36 months at a time to provide us the ability to refresh this infrastructure. The last lease, what we procured 196 terabytes of disks. This time we're increasing to 330 terabytes of disks. So the good news is the monthly allotment is actually dropping $2,280. So disks are getting cheaper. In anticipation of a question that would come is that why do we continue to buy disks in the cloud being so prevalent and things that we're doing? Just to let you guys know, we do utilize the cloud quite a bit. So Amazon S3, Azure is the Microsoft product, and then Office 365. Are all products that are in the cloud that we utilize here at the county. So your mail is in Office 365. We use Azure as our redundancy. And then some products for social services are running on the Amazon cloud. And as you probably read last week, Amazon, the largest cloud provider, had a very significant outage. And a lot of things were out for several days last week, or at least a good part of Monday and Tuesday. So this leads us to believe that we're still on the right path by keeping the heart of our infrastructure here at the county in our data centers to make sure that we can provide those services when they're needed. And I guess the other part of that is that, you know, this project is currently budgeted.
Okay.
Questions?
Questions for Todd? I'm afraid I'm not smart enough to ask any intelligent questions.
Todd, do we have a lease now, or is our equipment out of the lease?
We are month-to-month on our current lease. So.
Okay, and did I hear you say that this new lease, it will be concurrent with the old lease?
Yes, we will turn in the other equipment back to the leasing company and receive this other. So it'll drop off the same.
Like $2,000 a month less.
Correct.
I like that.
Yeah. So just out of curiosity, this equipment, is it like as big as this room or as big as this table? Or
It's actually getting smaller every day because, and I have to stop myself and my guys will laugh because I always call it spinning disc because it's not anymore. We still have some spinning disc, but the discs keep getting smaller and smaller. So this is a very small rack of discs. I mean, it's about the size of the podium over there.
Really? So, wow.
Yeah, it fits in a very small enclosure. And I meant to mention this is also the core of what our infrastructure agreement is with the school system. So this is the storage that KCS and CCS utilize in our data centers.
Okay, any other questions? Thank you. Okay, next up from 4.16, Sheriff's Office, and we're glad to have Paul Hunt with us, and he has a guest as well.
I have Amy Birchfield, who's the manager at the animal shelter. The sheriff's office took over the shelter duties again last February. We hired Amy to take over that. At that time, we hired two other full-time employees, and we have several auxiliary employees. It's come to the point now that they need one more full-time employee as soon as we can to deal with the cats and the kittens. We thought we could do it 4 hours a day. It's turned into an 8-hour-a-day job with everything they have to do with the cats and the kittens that are coming in and getting ready to hit the busy time for the shelter. Time changes next weekend. People are out and about more. It's warmer outside. So we end up getting more calls. We end up getting more animals brought into the shelter. And instead of waiting for budget time, we kind of wanted to hit this a little quicker than that so we could be prepared for it. And I brought Amy along too. She can answer any questions as far as what this position would do with those cats and kittens and, you know, what we need that for.
Okay. Questions for Paul and Amy?
The only question I have is, and I certainly understand the need for that, is the expense. Did I miss that in here somewhere? Is there a cost or?
It wasn't on here, but okay. I did write down the other kennel tech we have is their salary is $30,100 right now. Yes.
So this is making the part-time full-time?
Kind of, sort of. It's the part-time's an auxiliary position, I think, if I'm not mistaken.
You were not going to give up the auxiliary
right,
hours, though.
No.
So okay. This is a brand new
position. It's a brand new.
Brand new.
The auxiliary hours also. Yes, brand new full-time. We still need some of the auxiliary hours to help us on the weekends and to come in when people are sick or take time off. I mean, it still has to run, so we need the auxiliary hours for that.
Are you proposing to pay for this with lap salaries for the remainder of this year, and then it would pick up in the new budget? Okay. So it will not increase the current year budget. We'll be able to pay for it with their lap salaries, and then next year we'll pick it up as a new employee.
And just to make sure I understand, lap salaries are positions that have become open that have not yet been refilled.
Yeah, there's especially large departments, yeah, like the sheriff's department, there's turnover, and during those times where they're advertising for jobs, or especially if they're extended times before they can fill them, that salary is still budgeted, so it's the money's there.
Right, thank you. Any other questions?
I'd just like to, excuse me, hear a quick rundown of a typical day over there and what you're dealing with.
Okay. So we do owner surrenders on Mondays and Tuesdays only, just to try to limit it. We take in 10 cats, 10 dogs per day, but that really quickly fills up. Like sometimes we're filled up 2-3 weeks out. We're booking appointments for the owner surrenders. However, stray animals, cats and dogs are allowed to be brought in every single day, Monday through Friday, noon to 4:30. And those get filled pretty quickly as well, especially during what we call crazy cat season. It's starting about now and starts to get a lot busier throughout the year, throughout the summer months, all the way into the fall months where it slows down. During the winter time, the cats and dogs slow down their population rates, but they really pick up during the summer months. So, but during the day, I've got my part-time technician cleaning the cats in the morning. And then I've got one full-time technician. He cleans all the dog runs during the morning, and then he does the intake. So he's running back and forth doing the intake of cats, which is in the front of the building, intake of dogs at the back of the building, and then also rearranging them as necessary. Like, we've got friendly cats, stray cats, feral cats, kittens coming in, all sorts of things, puppies and dogs coming in. So he's got to place them in proper locations. When we get full, we have to kind of combine them, not the dogs and cats, but, you know, two, three dogs together maybe, make sure they're not getting into fights or anything like that. So he has to know where to put them properly. And then he does a second cleaning in the afternoon as well. So when he's running back and forth with the cats and the dogs, it's a lot of work for him. Also, the cats and kittens, they do take a lot of work. We need to vaccinate them, medicate them. When you house a lot of animals together, there's just disease in the area. And we are mandated by the state to care for them. So we have to medicate them for their upper respiratory infections and any other little issues they may have. And that takes a lot of time as well. Kittens, they always need eye meds and oral meds for their upper respiratory infections. So it's doing that AM and PM, as well as puppies and kittens under the age of 6 months must be fed twice a day. So we have to feed them as well. And kittens need a lot of care. I mean, we have up to 40, 50 kittens plus cats. It takes a lot of time. So having that extra person there versus, I've been doing it the past year, and it's just not too much for one person to do right now. So that extra full-time person will just help out a lot and actually make sure we get everything done in time. We also try to put pictures up of the cats and dogs, the stray animals, to hopefully get them back to their owners. So taking the pictures, vaccinating them, scanning them for microchips, all that takes extra time as well. So
the one thing she failed to say too is with Amy and Jana, who's the other full-time, they do a lot of rescues and adoptions, and it takes away from that when they're having to go take care of the cats and the kittens in the afternoon because there's nobody else there to do it. So it kind of pulls them a different direction. You know, they're trying to find owners for these animals that are there.
I don't have any questions. I do have a comment, though, and that would be, I think, if David, when he listens to this might be a good idea for a good out and about segment to inform the public about the animal shelter. I mean, most people know that it's out there, but they don't know the procedures that goes on there and how to rescue or adopt an animal.
Mm-hmm.
And so that might be a potentially good out and about segment sometime in the future at the animal shelter there.
That's a great idea.
Appreciate the job you guys do out there.
Thank you.
You know, I know that it can't not be easy, but somebody has to do it, so we appreciate what you do out there.
Thank you.
I'm not a cat person, but I thought every day was crazy cat season.
It is. It slows down, thankfully, in the wintertime a little bit, but come out and visit us during the, you know, April, May months, and it'll be exploding with cats and kittens everywhere. So.
Well, thank you for your hard work.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next up is 4.17, access agreement for Lloyd Garman Lane. And Rich is going to talk with us about that.
Yes, Jonathan has pitched this one to me, but I have been involved in it. Out on Highway 49, where EMS station number 2 is,
Interrupt you just a minute. Where is the EMS 2 on 20? Where is it?
From Central DeBarry.
Yeah. Okay, see, that's what I needed. Thank you. Now I know where we're talking about.
There is, the EMS station, and down to the right, actually on the east side of it, there is actually a road called Lloyd Garman Lane. And it's actually within a private right-of-way that's on county property. It accesses some property behind and to the right or to the east of of the EMS station, and also the Gethsemane Baptist Church, which sits essentially across from the EMS station. And the lady that that owns the property behind Ms. Stoudemeyer wants to subdivide and create another lot in her property that's back there. And we've been talking with her and her attorney, Steve Medlin, about how to deal with this. The present use of it is not a a burden or a problem for the EMS station, the use by the church or by Ms. Stoudemeyer, and the amount of use from the way the property is used now. But with this, after this additional lot, which won't create any particular problems either, we were concerned that there might, because of the amount of property that she owns back there, that there might be an increase of the use sufficient that it could interfere with the operation of the EMS station. So we've worked out an agreement with her, which is in your materials, to basically require that after this second lot that she's putting back there, that any subsequent rezoning or subdivision of her land would require county approval. So that's essentially what the agreement provides. Actually, the way her property is configured, she actually has a right-of-way down the eastern side of her property, but it's never been opened, and it's heavily wooded, and the topography of it is such that it would be very expensive to try to open that up. But if she were to attempt to develop her property further, you know, that may be what she would have to do. Like, say, if it were developed in a proposed way that would have the potential to interfere with EMS operations. So that's essentially what we've worked out with her, and would you know, submit that proposed agreement for your approval.
Well, you said she was subdividing it, but our description says it's recombining.
So that's too many years of doing subdivision administration, and it's kind of a legal harem splitting. She has two lots. She's redoing the lot lines, and we'll end up with two lots. So there isn't an increase.
Just moving the lines.
It's just
around.
Moving the lines.
I see. I mean, I don't have a problem with it. I just didn't understand.
Yeah. No, that is technically correct.
Right. Okay.
But she actually is going to sell that parcel to somebody else, and that's why we consider it. However, you can look at it both ways, but that's essentially what's happening. There'll be separate ownership of that new lot number one, as it's indicated on the map.
Okay, questions? Very good, thank you. We'll move on to 4.18, easements for Duke Energy, and Jonathan Marshall will tell us about that.
We actually received these separately as a request from Duke Energy, but I've combined them. They are similar in that we have private property owners who need improvements to the power supply in order to supply, in one case, a home, and in the other case, a business that's under construction. In both those cases, an existing pole that is adjacent to county property, both of these are the poles, the actual power pole is in the right-of-way of the road. But they need to have a new guy wire for support, and that requires an easement onto county property. So the first one is a residential unit that's being constructed at the end of Rankin Road. Rankin is on the east side of the reservoir. Actually used to be a through road that now dead ends at its southern terminus at the reservoir. There is a new house that's been constructed down there, and I'll explain why this is important in just a moment. But they have completed that house, and then what they're waiting on is their final power supply. The lot had power, but it wasn't sufficient for the new house that's constructed. So they're able to construct the house, but now for their permanent power, they need these improvements from Duke Energy. And since that's the only thing that's required for them to get occupancy, we've completed all our inspections. They are requesting that you make an exception and approve this easement tonight. The second one is also is near EMS-2 on Highway 49, and there's actually two easements required. There's a guy wire that will go on to county property, the EMS-2 property,
on the same side of the road where they're constructing a Family Dollar store. But in addition, that power supply is coming from a pole on the south side of 49 on the central Cabarrus High School property, which is also owned by Cabarrus County. So there's also a guy wire that needs to be tied in there for support to that pole as they extend this additional service. So really there's two easements involved with that one, and it is to help serve that new Family Dollar under construction. I've had some back and forth both with the City of Concord as well as the engineer for that project about some screening. There is an area where we have some existing vegetation that will be between the EMS station and the Family Dollar. And my concern is that if that has to be removed for this construction, that it be replaced. So I've already communicated that to them. In addition, there was some question about the required screening from the City of Concord, and I've already raised that issue with the city, and we got a good resolution to that.
So a lot of activity out around that EMS station tonight.
Yeah. So, and I guess the other question I often get, and particularly when I get contacted about these things, is these are fairly minor. They are 30-foot easements, and Mr. Cook and I were discussing how they seem rather wide. I believe from their diagrams, it's showing they want 15 feet on each side of the overhead lines, and that's why you have such a wide easement for such a what seemingly small thing. But even as small as these easements are, they need to come before the Board of Commissioners for approval.
Okay, questions for Jonathan? Okay, and they are
requesting. There's one last thing. If you read the easements closely, there were some typographical errors. We've gotten those corrected also.
Okay, and you are suggesting that we suspend the rules to approve this tonight for the homeowner specifically?
For the homeowner specifically, but if you wanted to handle both at the same time, I think we resolved all the issues with them.
Okay. Okay, at this time I would entertain a motion that we suspend the rules to act on this tonight.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? No. Motion passes. And so at this time I would entertain a motion to approve the requested easements for Duke Energy outlined in item 4.18 on our agenda.
I'll make a motion that we approve the request, but one question. And Jonathan, that guide wire goes across 49 over to the Central Cabarrus property?
The power line goes across 49 to the Central Cabarrus property. The guy wire goes back towards Central Cabarrus. It's just a support with the additional load, as I understand, on that pole. They need some additional support.
Okay. Is there a second to the motion that's on the floor? Okay. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Okay. Moving on to item 4.19. Funding requests for items at the Cabarrus County Schools bus garage, and Pam Dubois will tell us about that.
Yes, I have participated in the budget process for Cabarrus County Schools for the last 4 years, and we have several other county employees that are now participating. And through the process that they utilize, it's a program called TREGO, and they place projects out there and they vote on them based on certain criteria. And how they end up in the process by voting is how they come down to the funding process. For this fiscal year, there was $17,942,099 competing for $1,020 worth of monies. We have had conversations to take some of the projects and place them in our CIP program, so that will eliminate some of the projects from being incorporated within this list. But there were two things that were outstanding that have been voted on for the last 3 years and have not made it to the funding process. And Cabarrus County, the garage services both school districts. It services Kannapolis City Schools and Cabarrus County Schools. And we as a county, we fund the initial purchase of all the new buses. And we're continuing to buy more and more buses. So these particular items are causing issues within the efficiencies within the garage that I wanted to bring to your attention. And I have had this conversation with the superintendent of Cabarrus County Schools to explain why we felt like, from staff point of view, that these items really needed to be addressed. The first item is three floor lift systems for buses. And on the explanations is that there are 14 garage bays that are assigned for the mechanics for bus repairs. The mechanics are having to wait in line for one of the existing units to complete certain types of repairs on the assigned vehicles, resulting in longer park time for buses. And the number of buses that are in the longer park time average 15 buses that are waiting to be repaired. Some of these repairs follow under safety and workers' compensation issues, so that if they don't have a lift that takes the vehicle up, they're crawling up underneath it, and they're on creepers that roll up underneath the vehicle. And there are situations where workers' compensation claims can actually come into consideration for the mechanics who are having to crawl up underneath these vehicles. But the biggest portion of the concern we had was the inefficiencies of the mechanics waiting to be able to service those vehicles. The second part of that request was a bed for a wrecker. The school buses have gotten heavier, and 90% of their fleet requires the larger wrecker. They have only one of those, and they're in need of a second one. The bed for the wrecker, the state of North Carolina will not pay for the bed, but they will pay for the truck that pulls the bed. So the truck that pulls the bed is roughly $95,000, and the bed is somewhere around that same price tag. So for 50% of the cost, we get the entire vehicle. So what we're asking for is to include the purchase of the three floor lift systems, if I can get that out, and the bed for the wrecker, so they could proceed on with the bus garage to make the whole system more efficient and safe, and to keep the buses on the road and keep them in operations. And that request would total $180,500. And there were excess revenues collected in the property taxes for delinquent. So that there was a revenue that's available to fund this project, and staff feels that this is something that needs to move forward. Trying to find things that we as a county are responsible for, and maintenance is one of those items, and we're trying to do what we can in the deferred maintenance area and the repairs, and this was actually something that benefited both school systems, so it's not just one school system that this takes care of. And of course, you've already heard the bus request for this year, and then when the high school opens, the additional more buses, and these things are in need to be moved up to get taken care of, so that those operations can continue on and be safe for the actual employees, but more efficient to keep the buses on the road.
So I have participated in the last 3 years and been through this process and have heard that, and these items are probably never going to come out on that process, you know, just because of the way, and it's parents and school staff and, county commissioners and county staff and people. And so I don't think it's ever going to come to the top. But I would just commend you guys as a staff, and this is just another sign of how fortunate we are that you hear these things, you understand where they come from, and the savings that it's going to do and the need for it, and that it's not going to come anywhere, and found a way to make it happen. I would totally support that after listening for the last 3 years and knowing they're never going to get it if something doesn't happen. So thank you for taking the initiative and bringing that here.
Not only is it not going to happen, if you look, both items fell from 15-16 to 16-17. So they're moving in the wrong direction. So that's
they failed again this year.
I don't mean failed like didn't get funded. I mean fell out of priority.
Yes. So they were 9 or 10, I can't remember exactly, but they were on the lower spectrum of the list again this year.
Yeah. So, well, Mr. Chairman, I would just maybe make the one small suggestion. I will echo what Commissioner Hunnicutt said, is kudos to staff for finding something that's correcting an inefficient problem. And what I may request is that may be an item that you want you and Commissioner Honeycutt approach at a chair vice chair meeting. That Lynn and I both have experience on the flip side of the Trego process, and there's a lot of good that comes out of it. But at the bottom where the rubber meets the road, their board has to be able to see some of these things that we're in partnership with them trying to fund and keep buses on the road. The same night we have funding for 20 more, that ought to send up a flag somewhere over there that says, hey, we can't just keep using one garage, one stall, or whatever the case may be. So it just made, you know, a minor suggestion of something that probably needs to be talked about, so that they're aware that while we're not, let me see how I want to say this, we are required, it is our fiduciary responsibility to look over their shoulder. You know, right. We're not doing it because we're mean or we don't want to be friends or anything like that. That's our responsibility. So this is a good example of that. When we do that, the taxpayer is going to come out ahead. So anyway, thank you very much for finding that. I think this is certainly something that needs to be done.
I certainly agree with both of you, and having been on the board for several years, this type of oversight and relationship has not always existed. And I applaud staff for being engaged and being aware of this, and that enables us to improve some of these situations. And I think that's one of the good examples of the reason it's set up. You know, folks that are on the school board and school administration, they are supposed to be about education. And that's the top priority for them. And of course, you know, we are more about how do we pay for it and dealing, you know, bus garage lifts don't directly improve education. Indirectly, certainly they do, because it provides an ability for those students to get to school. But I think that's our relationship is working very well, I think, in that area. And that give and take provides some better solutions, which, and this is a good example of that, I think. Any other questions or comments?
Well, there were several staff members that were involved in the process, and what was competing in that $17 million were the school buses and the mobile units. So I think we've got to work through pulling some of the things out of that are competing for that particular pot of money, so that certain things get replaced, like band instruments and classroom furniture and things like that. So we're working to try to come up with a solution to kind of put pots of money in places, and how they can kind of say, well, this is how much money you have here, and these are the type of items you can take from that particular pot, and then put them through the CIP process for some of the larger things, so that we know about them ahead of time, kind of like we had in the retreat with the mobile units and the buses. And then they have their reoccurring money for their smaller projects that they actually do with their staff within buildings and grounds. And I think we're headed somewhere in that direction to start fixing some of those problems, but it's going to take a while to get there. And I think we're coming to some conclusions on how we can address some of these items. But they all do understand that some of these things just won't make it to the top, because, you know, when you're looking at school buses versus this, they're going to go for the school buses because the kids got to get to the school, but right. Eventually the bus is going to break down. We internally, between Jonathan and Mike and Kyle, have a different process when it comes to capital, and it comes down to a couple of people who evaluate that, and they know year to year what projects don't make it to the top. And the problem with the Trego process is it doesn't make it to the top this year, it doesn't make it to the top next year. Well, guess what? More stuff has moved into it, and it still doesn't make it to the top, where I think our staff looks at the age of the project and balances everything out. And with Trego, it works really well with the operational expenses, but it becomes very difficult when it comes to some of the capital stuff that's year after year after year that doesn't get funded, and more new stuff keeps getting added to the list. So no, you know, nothing against the way they're doing it. It's just it doesn't seem to be an efficient way to get to those capital items because the demand is so great.
Thank you for finding a solution. Any other questions or comments? Okay, we'll move to 4.20, and that is the dissolution of the Food Policy Council. Jonathan is going to talk with us about it.
So this was when the Board of Commissioners originally created the Food Policy Council in 2010, as you can see from the agenda item that Ms. Smith put together, that this is the last appointed members came on in December of 2013. Part of our evolution of the oversight of the farm and the and all the different things that are overseen by the Food Policy Council was a push towards them creating a nonprofit. So that has been renamed the Farm and Food Policy Council. They have achieved the 501c3 status, and as such, they had to set up a board to go with that. So they've actually kind of reconfigured that board where they have a larger group that meets, a medium-sized group, for lack of better words, and then the oversight board that meets once a quarter. We still work with them. We still have staff that meets with them as the need arises. We actually host them here in this room. There may be some changes to that, but at this point, it's no longer a board that the Board of Commissioners would appoint members to. So just a dissolution from your standpoint. From the standpoint of the policy and activities, they are going strong and, in fact, have achieved some of those goals that the board set out for them. I will say that I discussed this with a member of the Farm and Food Policy Council, so they would be aware of it, and they were in agreement and understood, and actually said with their nonprofit, they need to be separate. In addition, I was contacted last week for a support letter from the county manager's office for some grant monies that they're seeking for the farm. And was able to, with that was actually for CFSA that contacted me about that. It was directly tied to some of the Board of Commissioners' goals and objectives, and was able to supply that letter to them.
Excellent. I think this is also a very positive thing, that something that starts here and spins off and does good work on its own.
And Commissioner Poole is, I think, personally aware of all the different activities. They really have expanded with this board, the number of activities they've undertaken. It's so much more than just our farm and incubator property. It really is a very much larger approach to food policy issues throughout the county.
Great. Questions for Jonathan? Okay, we'll move on to 4.21, resolution amending the Board of Commissioners meeting schedule, and Megan will talk with us about that.
Good evening. About this time every year, the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners sends us what we used to call the meeting in a box. Now they're calling it our legislative meeting. Since your agenda packet went out, I worked to contact our local legislative delegation. I heard back from 3 out of 4. And they all said that Friday, March 24th works well for them. If that date still pleases the board, and if you would be willing to suspend your rules and approve the resolution to amend your meeting schedule, then we can proceed with that date, and I'll send out a calendar invite and a notification to everyone.
Megan, what time is that meeting?
9 a.m. to 10 a.m. here in the multipurpose room.
Okay, and that is certainly, as all of our meetings are, open to the public, and that might be quite interesting for some citizens to attend that meeting. In the past, it has not been televised, but I don't think we've ever had members of the public since I've been involved that have come to that meeting, but certainly they are welcome and might enjoy it. Questions, commissioners?
I'll make a motion to suspend the rules.
Okay, we have a motion and a second that we suspend the rules. Any discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. And at this time, we'd entertain a motion approving a resolution amending the Board of Commissioners 2017 meeting schedule.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. And we move on to the approval of the regular meeting agenda, which you all have before you. And I think, as we discussed earlier, our issues with the tax refunds are already in the right places. Are there any other adjustments that anyone feels is needed.
Chairman Morris, you need to remove item F3 because you've already approved it.
The easements for Duke Energy, correct. Remove F3. And the last one where we amended the rules was not on there, correct? That was...
Correct. No, it's not.
Yeah, meeting schedule. Okay, does anyone see any other adjustments? With the removal of F3. Right. Okay, is there a second to that motion? Okay, any discussion? All in favor, please say aye. All opposed, no. That motion passes. I'm happy to announce that we do not have need of a closed session tonight.
Darn.
So unless there is anything else, we stand adjourned.
Yay. Well, that's a pleasant surprise.